Welcome to the P Talks. This is our first research talk with, and now I'm going to mess it up, even though you just told me how to say your name, Tej. Okay, that's a nod of like you were close, but not that great. So I'll take that.
It was good.
Of the University of Groningen, which I've definitely also pronounced wrong because I just heard you pronounce it for the first time, and I know that I've said that wrong. Will you say, how do you say that?
Groningen.
Okay, right. I'm not going to attempt that. So yeah, firstly, thank you so much for coming, Tej. And if anyone has a question for you, they can drop it in the chat or the Q&A or into either of those two things at any point during the talk. And we will be at the very end after you've given the presentation, people, I will put those questions to you. And if people want to save their question, hide it for themselves, they can also raise their hand and I'll note it down and then I can pass over to them and they can ask you the question themselves after you finish the talk. So, and all that will happen in the second half. So once again, I'm as you probably already learned, Tej, and people who know me in the audience already know, is that I do love to waffle. So rather than keep on talking, I'm just going to be quiet and I'm going to hand over to you now. So yeah, over
thank
to you.
Thank you. And I'm trying to open the PowerPoint. Let me see. Can you all see it now?
Yes, I don't know if everyone else can. I can definitely see it.
Then probably the rest can also see it. So, well, thank you for having me here. It's a nice opportunity, I think, to talk about my work. And I think it's also a very good initiative by the university to organize these kind of talks, because I think it's a very important topic to talk about, also to get insights on different researchers working on these themes. So I'm very happy to be able to discuss my work, or at least part of my work, because we don't have that much time, 20 minutes, I believe, on topics which I hope might be of interest to you. So my name is Tej Bouwman, weird Dutch name. I'm from the University of Groningen, again, a place with a really typical Dutch name. And today I'm going to talk about a value base for climate action. So I will mostly focus on values and how values relate to climate action and environmental actions more broadly. But before I start with my talk, I would first like to ask you to answer some questions. Let me see. Yeah, now it's working. Well, we aren't with a huge amount of people, but I think it might be a nice exercise to fill in those questions. So I would like to ask you, before I tell you anything about my presentation in detail, to go to menti.com, use this code and fill in two pages, well, basically these four questions and four additional questions. One, the first page is about yourself. The second page is about what you think people in the UK find important, or how well this fits with their views, perspectives, values. So I give you a couple of minutes, 2-3 minutes to fill those in, and then I will continue with the rest of the presentation. And by the way, for those who might view this video a bit later, I will keep the Menti open so you can also access the questions in the next 2 weeks or something. So if you want to answer them, you still have some time to do that. I see some responses being submitted. Very nice. I'll wait for an additional 2 minutes. Jack, maybe can you confirm whether you can go to the second page or not?
When
the questions look super similar.
Right, no, when I finish the questions, it says, please wait for the presenter to show the next slide. So I can't see anything else.
Okay, then it changed it again. That's weird because it should be audience space, but
It just did it for a second and then disappeared again.
That's always the issue with these things. Well, I think most of you filled in the first one.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, then I will just continue because otherwise it will also be on the video a very long pause for the people just watching. Then I think the main message I can just tell you, and it might be say more if more people fill it in. So I will just continue. Basically, those questions are typical value questions. I will discuss a little bit more in a minute, but so, just so you know what you just filled in. So a brief overview of the things I will be talking about today. So first I will give a very short introduction about who am I, but more importantly, what's the research group I'm working in, what kind of work are we doing, and what's environmental psychology. I will keep it short also because of the time limit. Thereafter, I will focus on the main part of the presentation, so values, what are values, which values are relevant, and then particularly in the context of environmental and climate action. And then at the end of the presentation, I will focus on how you could use or utilize these values to promote environmental action. So what kind of things can we learn from research on values when we want to promote environmental or climate actions? So about environmental psychology in general. So maybe some of you already followed a talk I gave, I don't know, a couple of months ago, also at your university, in which I also briefly introduced environmental psychology. So for those, sorry that I mention it again, but I think for those who didn't, it's good to give you a sort of a general idea about what environmental psychology is. It's not the most well-known, or at least not yet the most well-known field or specialization within psychology. I think many people who study or think about psychology focus on the clinical psychology part. Probably many of you focus also on the social psychology part if you're from that group. And what we do in environmental psychology is really focusing on the interaction between people and the environment. So it also overlaps a little bit with social psychology, but it's about how people on the one hand influence the environment, and also how the environment influences people. And really these dynamics is what we study within environmental psychology. Our research group, so the environmental psychology research group, I had to count quickly, so I'm not entirely sure whether the numbers are 100% accurate, but I think we have around 10 senior researchers, around 6 postdocs at this moment. We have also some open vacancies, and we have around, I would say, 10 PhD students in our group, and we also there have some vacancies open. So if you're interested in continuing a career in science, and then particularly within environmental psychology, it might be nice to have a look at the website to see whether there are positions open which might be of interest to you. We also have our own master program. Jack already said that he was also sort of interested in this program. It focuses specifically on environmental psychology, the things I will be talking about today, more personal factors which drive people, their environmental behaviors, but also more group social factors and contextual factors which drive people, their environmental behaviors. And we have quite a diverse program focusing on many different aspects in these relationships between people on the one hand, environmental, the environment on the other hand, and then particularly focused on environmental problems. So why is environmental psychology important, particularly now? Well, many environmental problems are largely caused by human actions, so climate change, plastic soup, biodiversity loss. People's actions have a huge role in the origins of these kind of problems, and also cause that these problems are still there and are not mitigated yet. And also the mitigative and adaptive actions strongly depend on individuals and groups' attitudes and actions. So people need to change their behaviors, need to change how they think about certain things, and need to change whether they find things acceptable. So a lot of behavioral change is also needed to sort of mitigate and adapt to these environmental problems. So now the main part of my talk, which is about values and environmental action. And where I will be talking about mostly is about how values relate to environmental action. But first, before we can discuss this, so how values relate to human, to environmental action, we need to have a basic understanding of what human values are. In our research, we mostly focus on Swartz's theory of basic human values. And I'm not sure how familiar you are with this theory, so that's why I'm also sort of explaining the sort of general definition, what a value is. And values are typically defined within this literature as very general goals, which are universal. So basically every person in the world endorses these values to some extent, which are desirable. People, the outcomes of these things are seen as positive, so desirable aspects. They are typically abstract, so it's not about one specific behavior, but about very general behaviors. It's a general thing, it transcends situation, it transcends context. So it's our very general, universal, desirable goals that basically all the people within the world endorse to some extent. Although everybody endorses those values, there is variety in what values they prioritize over others. So I can, for instance, prioritize one value over another, whereas for another person, this might be the other way around. So although all those values are important to every individual, or basically every individual, there's a lot of variation in how people prioritize one over the other. And values are typically used as guiding principles. And by that, I mean that people typically, when they evaluate a certain action or decision or person, they base this on values. So the benefits and costs this might have for specific values. And when we talk about environmental action, basically four basic human values are critical, are really important. And those four are the biospheric, the altruistic, the hedonic, and the egoistic values. And two of those values, the biospheric and the altruistic values, are typically positively related to climate actions and environmental actions. So people who strongly endorse biospheric and altruistic values are typically more likely to engage in climate and environmental actions. Biospheric values are about caring about nature, the environment, these kind of topics, also feeling connected to nature and the environment. Altruistic values are more about social well-being, fairness, these kind of principles. On the other hand, you have also what we sometimes call self-enhancement values, which are the hedonic and the egoistic values. Hedonic values focus on gratification of one's desires, pleasure, comfort, such topics, and egoistic values focus more on gaining possessions, status, and power. And those values are often negatively related to climate actions and environmental actions. Because typically, or many people associate those environmental and climate actions with costs for those values. So for instance, it might be inconvenient to take a certain action. You might need to change habits, which might have costs for hedonic values, or it might be very costly to engage in certain actions. Of course, this is not the case for all environmental actions. So some environmental actions might also be more likely taken for people with, for instance, strong egoistic values. So it might be financially beneficial. So for instance, saving energy also saves you costs. It will be cheaper for you. So you might also be more likely to engage in those behaviors if you strongly endorse egoistic values. However, biospheric values are typically the strongest predictors of environmental action. And typically when people strongly endorse biospheric values, they are typically more likely to engage in environmental actions. So how are those values endorsed? So what you can see here on the right-hand side is outcomes of the European Social Survey. European Social Survey is a survey which is conducted across many different European countries. You can see them as well as Israel, by the way. So not a European country, but a long list of countries. And part of this survey is also the value questionnaire. And actually the questions you answered at the start of this, this presentation are part of that questionnaire. And measure hedonic, egoistic, biospheric, altruistic values, as well as many others, but those are relevant within this context. And what you can see when you look at this image is that people typically report to quite strongly endorse biospheric values. So you can see them here, those are the green squares, as well as altruistic values, which are the blue diamonds. And that those are typically more strongly endorsed and more prioritized than all the values on average, which are these black crosses, as well as hedonic and egoistic values, which are typically endorsed much lower. And also, if you look, for instance, for United Kingdom, you see the basically the same pattern here. So it's actually quite a positive message. Many people tend to, or at least report, that they care a lot about topics like biospheric and altruistic values, which does underlie many environmental and climate actions. So there seems to be quite a strong personal value base for climate actions and environmental actions. And when we look at your results, let's see whether we see sort of a similar pattern. So here you can basically see a similar pattern, I guess. So what you typically indicate is that the bottom one is biospheric values. Well, it's maybe also a bit of a biased sample because I guess many of you are working on this topic and therefore also attending this presentation and interested in these kind of topics. So But you also generally indicate to care a lot about the environment, care a lot about more altruistic values, also quite a lot about hedonic values, and less about those egoistic values. And actually, this is quite a common pattern when you look at this data set. So also across Europe, which is a representative sample, so not a biased sample like you, but a representative sample of the European population, you sort of see a similar pattern. So if those values, those biospheric and altruistic values, are then so strong, why don't we act accordingly? There are different reasons. And one reason you often hear is that there might be some kind of self-presentation bias. So people like to present themselves in an overly positive way and might therefore also report to care a lot about these kind of topics, while in reality they don't care that much about that topic. Although this is to some degree might be right, and indeed there's some evidence to suggest that people sort of present themselves in an overly environmental, pro-social way, it also doesn't paint the whole picture. So there's still also a lot of evidence suggesting that people actually do care a lot about the environment, about altruistic values. It might be slightly weaker than people's self-report on these kind of measures, but the fact that they see this as a social desirable answer already indicates that it's an important topic to them and that they think it's an important topic to society. But also if you look at, for instance, what predicts certain behaviors, and also when you look at manipulations in which you present certain things in either sort of biospheric or supporting biospheric ways or egoistic ways, so financial benefits versus environmental benefits, you often see in a lot of research that actually focusing on those environmental benefits is typically more convincing to people than focusing on these other benefits. So although there might be a slight self-presentation bias, I would say this is not a complete story. And I think people are generally quite strongly motivated to engage in these kind of behaviors. Another reason why people might not engage in climate action, or at least not live up to those biospheric and altruistic values, is because of value conflicts. So what I already mentioned is that it's not like that people care about one value and not care about another, so are environmental but not egoistic, but typically they endorse both to a certain extent, as well as for the hedonic values. And it might be that one behavior might be clearly beneficial for biospheric values, but might have huge costs for other values, like hedonic, egoistic, or even altruistic values. So what you can see on this this image is someone cycling, which is clearly more pro-environmental than taking the car. But if it's raining a lot, there's a huge conflict with those hedonic values. It might be super inconvenient to take the bike. So in such cases, people might not act in these kind of ways, not because they don't care about the environment, but the cost for the other values are more important. So also when you try to address or motivate people to engage in pro-environmental behaviors, it's also really important to take those other values into account and also make sure that you address those values and make sure that the cost for these values are lowered or reduced in order to promote environmental actions. Another reason why people might not live up to their values, so not live up to those biospheric and altruistic values, is a lack of knowledge. So people often don't know how they could act in a pro-environmental way, or are not aware of the fact that they are not acting in a pro-environmental manner. So it's also important to let people know what they can do. So if you care about the environment, what actions could you take in order to behave more pro-environmentally? And also give them knowledge about what kind of impacts this might have, so that certain behaviors might actually be quite impactful. So another way to sort of make sure that people live up to their values is also generating knowledge about how to do this. So learn people about, educate them about what kind of actions they could take, and thereby also specifically focusing on biospheric and altruistic values, so environmental topics. Another thing, and here's again a sort of typical Dutch image, what might hinder people from living up to their values are habits, routines, and traditions. So people are used to act in a certain way, and in those conditions, they might not think about the consequences of these kind of actions. So quite stereotypically, if you're Dutch, you might eat a lot or might be used to eat a lot of cheese, and you might not think of the environmental impact of eating this cheese. And of course, there are many better examples than this, but there are many things we do during a day in which we do not think that actively about what kind of consequences this has. So in these kind of situations, you have to make sure that those values which are important to people are activated, and also that people have an idea about what the impacts are of these kind of behaviors. So only if you do this, this might help people or might enable people to act according to their biospheric and altruistic values. Another, and I think this is a very important reason why people do not act upon their values, is a sort of unsupportive context. So many people are unable or are only to a limited extent able to change certain behaviors. So for instance, if you rent an apartment, it might be very difficult to install, for instance, solar panels. So it's also very important to sort of support people in acting in these kind of ways. You might need to implement policies which might make it easier for people, might help people in acting in an environmental way, but you also might need to support them by financial incentives, but also new opportunities, creating techniques in order to do so. So it's also really important that there's a really supportive context for this. And related to this, and this is also one of the main things I focus on in my research, is the social context. So you have this more physical environmental context where people are living in, which might hinder them from engaging in climate action, environmental actions. But the same applies to the social context in which people are. And this was the reason why I asked you, but apparently didn't work, about the values of the UK population. So what you typically see, and actually it's my next slide, what you typically see, and this is for an American sample, is that people think that others care a lot less about the environment than they themselves do. So here you see a sample of Americans, which were either asked about their American identity, the conservative identity, or the liberal identity, the last two, depending on the political affiliation of them. But if you now look at, for instance, the American sample, you see that at a personal level, people tend to indicate that they quite strongly care about biospheric values and altruistic values, quite weakly care about egoistic values. But that when you ask this about the group, so the general, the average US citizen, you see a completely different pattern. And there you basically see that biospheric values are not that strongly, or that people think that other US citizens don't not that strongly endorse those biospheric values, that US citizens not that strongly endorse altruistic values, but that they relatively strongly endorse egoistic values. So people tend to have sort of a perception about others that they are far more selfish than themselves and care a lot less about biospheric and altruistic topics. This also can have huge impacts on people, their behaviors, or can have impacts on people, their behaviors. So what you see in those in these graphs is that so the first column is about the personal norm, which is basically the responsibility people feel themselves to act in a pro-environmental manner. The second one is a willingness to reduce their energy for the environment. And the last column is about energy saving behaviors. And what you see here is that the further in a graph they are to the right, the more strongly they think that fellow group members endorse biospheric values. And what you see is that the more they think people endorse biospheric values, the higher their personal norms to act pro-environmentally, the higher their willingness to reduce energy for the environment, and the higher their energy saving behaviors, particularly when they themselves don't care that much about the environment, so have relatively weak personal biospheric values. So particularly those people are influenced by the values of others. And also particularly the more strongly they identify with the group, which are the blue lines. So when people strongly identify with the group, they're basically, you can see on the top left, so this graph, you can see that the personal norm to engage in pro-environmental action goes up the more they believe fellow group members endorse biospheric values. But that when they weakly identify with a group, so with Americans, this might actually sometimes even go down, so might even demotivate them from taking action. So basically the main message here is, so if you look at the main effects, you also typically see that the more you think that fellow group members endorse biospheric values, the more likely you yourself are to also engage in these behaviors, also when you control for personal biospheric values. So I think we're already sort of at the end of the 20 minutes. So to sum things up, many people report at least to care a lot about nature, the environment and society. And therefore to promote environmental action, we need to enable them to engage or to live up to those values. And this can be done by reducing value conflicts. So make sure that environmental actions are not only beneficial for your biosphere or for people their biospheric values, but are also beneficial or at least not that costly for other values like hedonic or egoistic values, improve people's knowledge, so educate them about how they can live up to their values, make sure they also know what to do, increase awareness, so make sure that they also consider those values when taking actions, particularly when those actions are, for instance, more of habits or traditions, and make sure that people, well, both the physical or the larger societal context is supportive, but also the group they are part of are at least seen as being supportive, because at this moment people generally tend to see fellow group members as not being that supportive about biospheric values. And importantly, to end off, what's also I think really important message to keep in mind, that is, if people are able to live up to their values, there's a lot of research to show that when you act in line with your values, people are actually becoming more happy, so it increases your well-being. So people who engage in actions which support their personal values are generally happier, indicate to have a better well-being or a higher well-being. So it actually might also be beneficial for people themselves, might make them more happier. And this is also particularly found for pro-social values and biospheric values. So people who live up to those values typically get a good feeling out of it. So that was it. That was the story I wanted to tell. And sorry, it's extremely hot here. So I'm sweating a little bit and I need some water, but I'm open to questions, comments, whatever. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Tej. That was I knew I was going to say your name wrong as soon as I tried it. Thank you so much. That was brilliant. So I have one question here for you right now, and then I have personally a lot of other questions that I would like to ask. So question from Gianmarco in the audience is, do you think that it's more important, and I think this is in relation to people who maybe their values aren't that focused on the environment, do you think it's more important to change individual behaviors or to change people's values?
Good question. I think it's good to look at, well, individual behavior is a bit difficult because there are so many different behaviors you might need to undertake in order to really make a change. So I would say then lifestyle changes would be better because that's sort of a group of behaviors. And changing values, yes, indeed, if values are not that supportive of climate environmental action, I would say, yes, it might be a good thing to think about how you could change those values. On the other hand, you see that people typically score rather high on these kind of measures. So not sure how much, well, there's probably something to win, but it might be really difficult to achieve that. And in addition to that, I'm not sure whether everybody would consider it ethical. So it's really something personal, something personally important to you. And who's allowed to say to you what you should value, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm not sure whether I think it can also cause a lot of conflict. And also there's also quite some research which shows that it's if you want to change people, their values, it's really difficult. So you need to it takes a long time. There needs to be sort of a specific situation or big event which changes their values or how they think about these things. So it might also be really difficult. So I think in that sense, I would say that it's first important that we make sure that people live up to their values. So many people indicate to care a lot about these things. So make sure that people are able to do this and also acknowledge that they care about it and therefore also act in this kind of way. So I think that's maybe a first step to take, and then maybe in the long run values might change. But I think it could, yeah, if you could change them, it could have a huge impact, of course. But whether you can change them and whether it's ethical to change them, I think that's also a very important question. I'm not entirely sure about these things.
Amazing. Thank you. That's a really good answer, I think, to the question. If anyone in the crowd, in the audience, does have any questions, please feel free to just drop them into the chat or the Q&A sections of the webinar, and I'll happily pass them on. Or you can just raise your hand and then I'll be, and then I can open it up for you to ask your question yourself. One thing that I wanted to, I'm going to save my question because I've just had another question come through in the Q&A, which is from Rachel, which is it best to meet people where they are? So for example, people motivated by egoistic values might be motivated by eco-friendly initiatives, which can save them money, So a financial message could be effective regardless of whether they care about the environment, or is it better to try to influence people's values so that we encourage people to be more biospheric in their values?
I think the first thing is sort of tailoring your message to the values people might have. I think indeed there's some research which suggests that that might work. Still, there's also quite some research which suggests that, for instance, focusing too strongly on those egoistic values might not always work for all behaviors. But of course, if it has huge financial benefits, it might be a good thing to mention too. Well, again, changing values might be a bit tricky. I think how certain behaviors relate to values, I think that could be further emphasized as well. So not everybody might say that a certain behavior has clear benefits for the environment or has clear costs for another thing. So how you communicate about these things, make clear what the costs and benefits are and how they relate to each other. I think that might be one way to promote these kind of behaviors. So in that sense, it's not necessarily changing the values, but more about how they relate those values to more concrete actions and making people more aware of these things. And I think another thing is also that you could make sure that people consider relevant values in certain contexts. So not in all contexts might be that you think about your biospheric values, even though you care about a lot about them. So in those contexts, it might be good to sort of activate those values, for instance, through product labels. And also about the egoistic values or hedonic values. So what's a bit of an issue there is that if you have a specific behavior and you want to promote it, you can of course put some kind of incentive on it. So make sure it's financially beneficial to engage in those kind of behaviors or in that specific behavior. The problem with that is often that it applies to that specific behavior, but not to other related environmental behaviors because people do it for the money. And if another environmental behavior is not financially beneficial, then they won't engage in these kind of behaviors. So the effects of these kind of actions might be beneficial for that specific behavior, but might not generalize to other sustainable behaviors, which could be a problem there. And also there's some research to suggest that if you take away the incentive, so for instance, if you subsidize something and then stop the subsidy, that then also the participation in these kind of things drop because people do it for the financial reasons, not for any other reasons, and therefore are not motivated anymore to engage in these kind of things. So in those cases, I think it's super important that you also stress the more stable, more general motives which might underlie these kind of behaviors.
Amazing, thank you again. Have you done any research on kind of weighting of these different values? So you've got kind of hedonic, egoistic, biospheric. Do you know which ones are, like, obviously there's, you're looking at them kind of separately, but then I wonder if someone scores a 6 in egoistic and a 6 in biospheric, which one wins out, or is that very context dependent?
Yes, it's a bit tricky to answer that question because I think already how people fill in those questionnaires might be influenced by these kind of biases. So people might like to present themselves in a certain way. There are ways to correct for this or but it's not always foolproof. So it doesn't work always in that way. And so it's quite difficult to compare those levels with each other. And I think it indeed also depends a lot on what kind of impacts a certain behavior has or is perceived to have. So even though you might say and maybe actually care more about the environment than about those egoistic things, it might be that I don't know, if you lower your thermostat or air conditioning in maybe in the current weather, you immediately have the feeling that it's too warm or too cold at that moment. So you experience that, and that's really prevalent at that specific moment. So you really notice it. Whereas the impact it will have on climate change is far more distant. And even though you might think climate change is more important than your immediate satisfaction of these kind of desires, then still it might feel more important at a specific moment to have a more comfortable climate. And so that complicates all these decisions quite a lot. So it's a difficult question. And there's also quite some research on these kind of things. Also on how people sort of, what they think are sort of good instantiations of value. So what are typical behaviors which relate to a certain value? But there's also, well, it's super subjective. It differs a lot between persons. And it's also really context and action dependent.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Had someone come in the chat just saying, thanks so much for providing us with this important information. So I thought I would pass that on to you. And like, I'll just make a call out again once more. If anyone has any questions that they want to ask, please feel free to just throw them in. We'll go for maybe another few more minutes if anyone else has anything that they do want to ask about. And obviously, if a question comes to you at a later point, you can obviously send me an email. I'll be happy to pass it on. Or maybe if you want to, you could share your email as well, potentially.
Yep, my email's also here, so you can also contact me if you want to know more.
Oh yeah, of course. About something. Definitely. Not paying any attention.
Was I also sharing the chat or not? Okay, good.
No, we can't see it, don't worry. I think I had one more question, which is about, I guess kind of related to one of the other questions that was asked, but how do you have any, seeing as, this is a quite a lot strong focus on values as being, or at least the kind of difference between values and behavior and the way people, ascribe themselves, the values they have compared to the behaviors they have. You talked about the potential of how it's not ethical to try and alter the values of people, or people might have a problem with it ethically. But obviously, dealing with climate change is a fairly universal, is a universal issue that everyone needs to, at least, like if we want to deal with climate change, we should expect or try and get everyone to play their part. How does, in your opinion, how do we deal with, or how do we either reach out to or change the behavior of, or change the consumption habits of, or whatever it is, how do we promote pro-environmental behavior in people who wouldn't classify themselves as caring about the environment, or wouldn't have, who would score very low in terms of, so it's not about aligning their behavior with their values, because actually their values don't align with the behaviors that we would want.
Yes, good question. I think so I think first I want to say that based on this data, it appears that a large group of people is quite concerned. So I would say it's important to focus on this group and at least make sure that those people are able to live up to those values and the things they find important. So that's also why I focused in my presentation on enabling people to do this. So to how to act in a way that's sort of supportive of your own values. But of course, there are also people who don't care about these kind of topics that much. And although it's also a bit difficult, of course, there are some people who might say the environment is completely not important to me, or doing something good for the environment might even be against my values or my principles. I don't think there are that many people who say something like that. And how to convince them, I'm not entirely sure. So what I know is that there are some groups of, for instance, climate skeptics, and there's quite a lot of literature on climate skepticism. But I think in those cases, it's not that they don't care about the environment, it's simply that they don't believe that climate change is a problem for the environment. So I think the climate skepticism, basically, some of their arguments are it's not that much of a problem for society or the environment. And it's more about the inability to link climate change to biospheric values than that they don't have these biospheric values. So in those cases, it might be beneficial to focus on, maybe instead of talking about climate change, focus on other things which relate to those values. So the environment more generally, and I don't know what drought or floods or these kind of things can do for things they care about. And then maybe don't mention the name climate change, because that might be sort of a controversial topic for them. So in that sense, it might be good to sort of make sure that people link certain behaviors, certain environmental behaviors, environmental policies to those things that are important to them. And I think indeed, so if for those people for which biospheric and altruistic values are completely not important, then it might be more beneficial to focus on other topics. But at the same time, I think most people like that most people who care about the environment also care about egoists, so possessions, and care about hedonic values. I think it's also the same way around. It's just a prioritization. So I think for everybody, these things are to a certain extent important, but they might find some more important than others. So I think then still you could focus on these kind of things, but maybe you should put the emphasis a little bit more on other benefits then as well.
One last question that I have, which kind of comes from something that's been put into the chat talking about defining what is meant by primary mental behavior and how it's much easier to save energy than to, for example, be regularly involved in climate activism, where obviously there's a lot of resistance. Do you see a difference in the values of, have you ever done any research looking at the values of people who are, say, very green in their daily lives versus people who are members of Extinction Rebellion or the, you know, school strikes for climate or things like that? Is there a value difference between those different, maybe levels is the wrong way to put it, but between those different types of climate activist or enthusiast? And do you see, so yeah, there's the, yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, so I think this sort of partly answers that question. So indeed, between groups, there are of course differences. And I think in the US, you have quite a clear split between the liberal or the people who vote liberal on liberal parties and the group who vote among conservative parties. And here you can also see that both on the so on the personal level, so those blue bars, you see that people who indicate to be conservative generally score lower on biospheric values and altruistic values than people who indicate to be liberal. So indeed, there are some group differences. Interestingly, there are also differences in how they perceive the group. So actually those groups you were just talking about, so in this case liberal, but also activist groups. So we also did some studies around the climate marches, how people perceive the people attending those climate marches. And there you generally see that people think that, their biospheric values are also strong. And actually in more larger sample, like the liberal sample in this case, they might even overestimate how important these kind of topics are. So it seems to be like sort of a stereotypical image people have about those groups, sort of overestimating how important such values are to these groups. So yeah, I think on two levels you see those differences. So how people perceive those groups, but also the people within those groups actually score typically higher on biospheric values.
So do you think
that might also be a motivation to join these groups because you care a lot about it?
Yeah, absolutely. Do you think we could use this to predict whether people are climate activists, or is it just retrospective? You know they're an activist, then you can see the values. Or do you think that, how predictive do you think these values are of the type of kind of input people have in terms of pro-environmental behavior? And could you predict it? What would you say is the best predictors?
I think so. If you look at pro-environmental behaviors, values are typically, so the biospheric values are really good predictors typically. So I think there's a lot of research showing that so the stronger endorsement of biospheric values is predictive of stronger engagement in pro-environmental and climate actions. It's often via a lot of other variables. So there might be many variables in between. So if you have strong biospheric values, you might be more aware of environmental problems. Because of that, you might also search for knowledge on how to mitigate these kind of problems, which might also increase a feeling of responsibility, efficacy beliefs, these kind of things, which then in turn might motivate your behaviors. So it might be a long path, but I think research is quite consistent on that at least stronger endorsement of those biospheric values is related to environmental and climate action. Causality is sometimes a bit of a tricky thing here because many of these research is correlational. But I think theoretically it makes most sense also to say that those values are sort of the drivers of these behaviors. And actually you see also that if people give feedback on their behaviors, that it has a larger impact on something like, for instance, a self-identity, so how people see themselves, but not necessarily their values, so that those values are relatively stable over time.
Amazing. Thank you so much. We've gone well over time, and I feel like I could sit here all day and talk to you about this. And thank you so much, everyone who came with questions, and to people who came along to the talk. And like I said at the beginning, if you know anyone who would be interested in this talk, or you want to watch it again or anything, it will be available from tomorrow on the P's YouTube channel, which you can just find by looking for the Psychologist for Environmental Action on YouTube, obviously. And maybe I'll email it out to everyone who said they would come along through Eventbrite after this has ended and once it's up and available, so you will know that it's there. But without waffling again, as I say, I always do, I think everyone wants to say thank you so much for coming and for giving this talk. It's been brilliant and been really interesting. And thank you so much for having turned up. And we would love to have you again at some point, I'm sure.
Thank you for inviting me.
Anytime.